life was coaching a junior high boys basketball team. There were several years I got to do that as my son was on that team, and then my next son was on the team. And junior high boys are unpredictable, and they are hilarious sometimes when you're coaching them. Like, there was this one time we were in a championship game. My star player had fouled out. The next guy up on the bench was this kid who had this sweet shot. He was maybe a little bit overweight, didn't get into the games a whole lot, but whatever he did, he'd surprise you with his ability. And so he came into the game. He hadn't been paying any attention to what was going on. Championship game. I was coaching against one of my former students, so the coach really wanted to win this game. And we were down by 1 point, and Ben gets the ball, and he starts to go the wrong way, and he shoots at the other basket. And because he doesn't miss, he makes the shot, and we end up losing the game by 1 point after our team stole the ball, came back, got another shot, but it was too little, too late. And that's kind of coaching junior high boys. Sometimes as I'd coach those boys, we'd see selfishness begin to manifest itself, especially at practice. We'd scrimmage a lot in practice, and we had this star point guard. If you have a star point guard in junior high, you can have like an 18-1 season because that one player can take over. And he knew it. And so my star point guard would love to just score almost all of our points, and it would drive the rest of our team nuts. I kind of liked the record that we had as the coach, but it was one of those selfish moves oftentimes by him that I had to correct. Sometimes we'd split up for a scrimmage, and I'd tell the boys to pick a couple of captains, and this incredible selfishness would begin to emerge about who was going to be the captain of the team. I actually read a story this week about another coach who told his boys to split up for scrimmage. They were going to pick captains, and the captains would pick the teams. And this coach was a teacher at the school. He had some meetings, and so he actually had to leave the boys in practice, and he just kind of trusted them that they would scrimmage and they would do just fine picking the captain. And anybody who's coached junior high boys over the years know that doesn't always work really well. And the boys couldn't decide on who the captain would be. Every one of them was stubborn. Every one of them wanted to be the captain of that team. One of the boys walked away and decided that he would spend time in the gym just practicing free throws. And so for about a half hour, while the rest of the team argued about who the captain would be, this kid, John, just sat there and he shot free throw after free throw after free throw. The coach came back from his meeting and recognized that his team hadn't scrimmaged at all. They were in the hallway arguing. He says, "What's going on here?" They said, "Well, we're upset because we want, you know, nobody could decide who the captain's going to be, coach." And the coach said, "I tell you what we're going to do. We're going to go into the gym, and you guys are going to shoot free throws, and the first person to make three free throws is the captain, and I'll be the other captain, and I'm scrimmaging against you guys." John, the kid that had been practicing for a half hour, was the only one who made a free throw that day, and John and the coach became the captains. You know, it's easy to see selfishness in others. We see it in traffic. We see it in the grocery store. We see it at work. Sometimes we see it in our own family members. Sometimes we... few months away from him going to the cross and being crucified. It's shortly in Mark's gospel after the transfiguration takes place, this event where Jesus goes up onto a mountain and he calls Peter and James and John to come with him. And as he's up on the mountain that day, Elijah and Moses appear with him. It's right after the story of healing a demon-possessed person. And the disciples are on the road with Jesus. They're heading back to Capernaum. They have been eyewitnesses to some of the most extraordinary events in the history of the world. They have been with the most extraordinary man in the history of the world, God in the flesh, Jesus Christ. And even though they've experienced so many great things, the disciples still have a ton to learn. And I'm glad the Bible has stories like this. I'm glad the Bible records people faults and all in Scripture. Jesus had just spoken to the disciples about his upcoming death. They didn't understand what he was saying. They weren't completely sure what Jesus meant when he talked about the Son of Man dying and rising again. And now as they are about to enter Capernaum in Mark 9:33, we read this. And when they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you discussing on the way?" But they kept silent, for they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. And he sat down and he called the 12 and he said to them, "If anyone would be the first, he must be the last of all and the servant of all." Busted! These disciples had been so busted by Jesus, by God in the flesh. Ever been busted? You ever had your hand caught in the cookie jar? Have you ever been caught in a lie? Have you ever been so guilty of something that no matter how hard you tried to prove otherwise, you know you may as well just shut up because there's nothing that you can do at this point to prove your innocence? The disciples displayed the natural desire to make things all about themselves. It wasn't the only time that they'd be guilty of such petty arguments. One time, the mother of James and John had come to Jesus, and she said, "Hey, Jesus, when you are in your paradise, when you get to heaven someday, will you give my sons, my two boys?" Above us. Elevation of one person over another usually doesn't go well, whether it's a junior high boys basketball team, when you're driving on 494 or 694 or 94, or with a group of grown men who called themselves disciples of Jesus. These men were the early church, and their dysfunction has been passed down throughout the centuries. I could tell you story after story of churches that are in conflict today, caused because of one person's preferences not being met. Healthy local churches are filled with people who will say, "I'm not going to let church be about me. This place filled with God's people should be all about Him." I mean, we sung the heart of worship today. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, Jesus. That's who we are as a church. We're a worshiping community. We're people that are coming together to live our lives in such a way that God would receive the glory. This ought to be a place that's filled with people who are not just about Jesus, but we're about his agenda, a radical agenda that suggested things like, in order to be first, we need to descend and to become last, to become the servant of all, as Jesus has just said. A radical agenda that calls us to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. A radical agenda that calls us to love our enemies. A radical agenda that suggests that God's kingdom isn't something that is just for some bright morning when this life is o'er and I'm going to fly away, but God's kingdom is something that Jesus told us to pray for now, that it might be manifested through his church, through his people, so that people on earth can get a glimpse of what life with Jesus Christ is like. It's time for God's people to rise up and to follow Jesus' example and to descend into servanthood. If we are going to be the church and not just go to church, it means that we're going to be people who chase hard after Christ's vision for his church, and not just our own. Where his vision and our vision conflict, we're going to submit ourselves to his vision. We're going to submit ourselves to being a people who will follow hard and chase hard after Christ. I say it often, but I'm so proud of the fact that Woodbury Community Church is a church that is filled with people that I believe are doing just that. People who are chasing hard after Christ's vision, God's vision, not just our personal preferences. There's a difference between Christ's vision and the preferences of human beings. Where our preferences and the preferences of other Christians conflict, we need to follow the example of Christ. We need to humble ourselves and not let our preferences get in the way of God's vision for his church. We're in the midst of a series called Be the Church that Jason Nygren kind of kicked off for us a few weeks ago. He preached so marvelously on the fact that as Christians, that we are God's church and we are called to serve each other, that you're here to give of the gifts that God has given to you to make an eternal difference in the world. And I wonder this morning, do you believe that? Do you believe that Woodbury Community Church is a better place because you are a part of God's church here? Do you believe that Woodbury Community Church is a better place because you're here, that you're an essential part of God's vision for this place? That the way that God made you with your unique gifts, your unique talents, your passion, your personality, your experiences, and the relationships that God has placed in your life, that all of those are things that are vital to WCC accomplishing the purposes that God has for his bride here. You're a gift to this church. And you're a gift that God has placed here beyond just being somebody that will come and listen to messages on a Sunday morning. But you're here to be a gift to others by engaging in their lives and by being the person that God has called you to be, using the gifts that he has called you and equipped you with to transform this world. Being a part of the body of Christ means that we need to sacrifice. But too oftentimes, believers want the church to be all about them. The opposite of servanthood is a church that I like to call me church. It's a selfish church. I have a video this morning that humorously illustrates what selfishness might look like in a church. Check out this video. It's a great video. When it plays, you're gonna. We'll try it one more time here.
Imagine a church where every member is passionately, wholeheartedly, and recklessly calling the shots.
I have a busy work week, and by the time Sunday rolls around, I'm tired. So how about a church service that starts when I get there?
Can do. When you arrive, we begin.
This guy, he plays by his own rules. We want to find a church where if he starts screaming, we're not the bad guys, right?
Say no more. If your baby's screaming, you stay seated. The others around you can leave.
You know, financially, Sherry and I don't give a lot to the church, but we'd sure like to know who does.
All right, if you join now, you'll know what every person gives in detail.
When I'm in the church service, can my car get a buff and a wax?
Not just that, but an oil change and a tune-up.
Hey, how about tickets to the Super Bowl?
That's asking too much.
I'm serious. If I'm going to join, I want tickets to the big game.
All right, you join now and we'll get you there.
I like a pony.
Look in your backyard. Me Church, where it's all about you.
Yeah, sometimes I think every one of us wish that that's what church was like. I mean, if we were, you know, totally honest and real, we all have some selfish moments in our life, but that isn't what church is about. And it's so easy to see in a humorous video. Selfishness in the church happens when we want to make it all about us. For this series, we've been using Tom Rainer's book, I Am a Church Member. And many of you have been reading along at home. We kind of went out of order last week and did week four, and this week we're doing week three, and the rest of the series, we're right on track. And I want to encourage you, again, if you haven't picked up that book and read it, to pick up a copy. It helps as we move along this series. But Tom Rainer in that book talks about a survey that Lifeway Research, the organization that he's the president of, did. With a number of churches to find out kind of what was happening in these churches. Every one of these churches would have been categorized as an inwardly focused church. And so they wanted to find out what are some of the characteristics of inwardly focused churches, churches that are no longer serving past their walls or no longer serving past their own members. In other words, they were self-serving churches. And in his survey, they found about 10 dominant patterns that were common in these churches. Patterns, and if you read the book, he has them all listed there. Patterns like worship wars over the type of music or the style of worship or the order of service. Inconsequential meetings that dealt with inconsequential items that rarely discussed what the church is supposed to be about, the Great Commission and the Great Commandment, and instead dealt with all sorts of inconsequential items. Churches that were so worried about their facility that they were no longer doing ministry because they wanted to make sure that the carpet didn't get stained or the furniture didn't get ruined or the walls stayed pristine, instead of recognizing that God has given us the facility that he's given us as a tool. I heard a story recently from a pastor friend that breaks my heart. That's a church that has an Awana program at their church, and it's a church who has used that Wednesday night program effectively in the past to reach dozens of kids with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we're going to be starting an Awana program this fall. We're really excited about it, training for that starting in February. This particular church decided as part of their Awana strategy that they would go to a neighborhood close to the church that was known for being a kind of a tough neighborhood. A lot of parents who struggled with addiction, a lot of kids who were kind of latchkey kids who never really saw mom and dad a whole lot, kids who might have to make their own meals, and kids who's, again, had to deal with their parents' addictions, had to kind of wash their own clothes if they wanted to get ready for school. Just a tough neighborhood to grow up in and a tough community. And so this church said, we ought to reach that community. We ought to do what we can to invite those kids to come to our Wednesday Night Awana program. And for about a year, they did a marvelous job with that. They actually had dozens of kids from that community coming to their Wednesday night program. Until some of the people in the church began to complain about the impact that those kids were having on their church kids. And when they decided that it was just too much of a risk to have kids from such difficult homes coming to church, and then they used excuses like, and they're throwing the balls too hard against the walls, and we actually got a hole in one of the walls, and the carpet's getting stained, and if these kids weren't coming to our program, our church facility would be better, and our kids would be safer. And the church caved. And they quit reaching out to those kids. And it breaks my heart when I hear that story. Because all of a sudden, this church that had an outwardly focused vision allowed some preferences to get in the way of God using them to transform a community that they were so marvelously being used in. And what kind of damage do you think that that does? What kind of damage do you think that does in a neighborhood and a community? When a church, starting with all good intentions, when things start to get a little bit rough, when you start to make an impact in the lives of people whose lives maybe look a little bit dysfunctional, maybe look a little bit messy, and might therefore make our lives look a little bit messy, that we quit. You see, the gospel's messy. Ministry is a messy thing. And if we're going to be the church that God has called us to be, then sometimes we're going to experience some messiness. Other factors his team found in inwardly focused churches were that there were some programs that were so sacred that even when they became ineffective, they just continued because they'd always had those programs. Instead of asking the difficult questions of whether or not this program was reaching people for Christ, the program became the end instead of life transformation through Jesus Christ. Fear of hurting somebody's feelings about stopping a program became more important than being a church living on mission. Churches with inwardly focused budgets or churches that rarely used what God had blessed them to reach beyond the walls of the church were some of the other factors, and you can read about the rest of them in the book. And almost every one of the behaviors above, church members were looking out for their own needs and preferences. I want music my way. I want the building my way. I'm upset because the pastor didn't visit me. I don't want anything to change in our church, because I'm comfortable the way that it is. You get the picture. I, me, myself. Church membership from a biblical perspective is about servanthood. It's about putting others first. That's the example that Christ sets all throughout the New Testament. Remember what he told the disciples in Mark 9:35? And he sat them down and he called the 12 after the little argument about who was the greatest. And he said to them, if anyone would be first, he must be last and the servant of all. If we're going to move from being a me-first church, a me-first Christian, to gospel-centered Christians, then we need to move from me to Christ. In Philippians 2:1-11, we have one of the most beautiful descriptors of Christ in all of Scripture. And it begins with taking a look at the difference that Christ makes in people's lives individually. In verses 1 to 4, we see Paul appeal to the church not to be me-focused, but to be focused on one another. Look at these verses. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interest of others. It's quite a contrast from the description that Tom Rainer gives us of churches that have ceased to be effective in their culture, churches that have become inwardly focused. Paul, like Christ before him, appealed to a local church, in this case, the church at Philippi, to complete his joy by having the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord of one mind, doing nothing out of selfishness or conceit, but to live in humility, considering one another as more important, more significant than ourselves, to look not only to our own interests, but also to the interest of others. Next Sunday night is our 2016 annual meeting. Since becoming the pastor of Woodbury Community Church 7 years ago, I've been amazed at how these meetings go. I came from a church that would have an annual meeting that just a small fraction of the church would come to. That's not the case here. I've been blown away at how many people show up to our meetings. I also came from a church where people would come to the meeting and nobody would ever say anything. They just kind of listened to the presentations that were being made and kind of, okay, leadership, we got you, we trust you, do whatever you're going to do. And here, it's been amazingly beautiful to see a church that's engaged in the process, a church that has incredible questions, a church that wants to see God do great things here. We don't always agree with everything in our annual meetings, but in the end, there's something beautiful that happens here. And every year at the annual meeting, if you've never been to one, come next week. You don't have to be a member to come to our annual meeting. All around this sanctuary, we hold hands together as the church, and we pray at the end of the night, because we're convinced that Jesus Christ is what makes us stronger. He is our aim. He is our focus. He is our purpose. As a church, we want to make much about him. And we're convinced that even in our differences on preferences that sometimes show up at an annual meeting, that God is bigger than it all. And there is something so beautiful and unifying at the end of that night of watching God's people come together in prayer, with humility, with an attitude that says, it's not about me, it's all about Christ. We move from me to Christ by doing what Paul outlines next in Philippians 2. Look at verse 5. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God Father. What's Paul saying? Become like Christ. What did Christ do? He became the ultimate servant. He was obedient to the will of the Father, even to the point of death. What's Christ calling us to do? Is there something that he's maybe asking you to do that you've been ignoring? I mean, we know that every day Christ tells us to take up our cross and to follow him. We know that Christ has called us to be people who love him with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. What are some of those practical things, though, that maybe you've sensed that God is calling you to do personally? Is there something that God's calling you to sacrifice? Is there something that he's telling you to get involved in? Is there something that he's telling you to give up? Is there someone that he is telling you to go reconcile with? Is there a preference that you have been so stubborn about fighting for that you've lost a picture of the bigger things that God wants to do here? What would it take for us to become even more effective in our mission of honoring God by making more disciples for Jesus Christ? Listen, I am certain of this. When God's people recognize that they are a gift to the body of Christ and that they have been blessed with at least one spiritual gift, and when they make a commitment to use that gift to join God in his mission, the church, and more importantly, the world will benefit. Do you believe that? Do you believe that when you live the life that God has given you to live and for his purposes, that our church and our world will be a better place? I don't have a doubt about that. 57 times in the New Testament, the word servant is used. It's a word that so embodies who Jesus Christ is and what he calls his followers to be. As Christians, we're called to be servants like Christ, putting others ahead of ourselves. Here's the lesson. You're a gift who possesses spiritual gifts. There are several passages in the Bible that talk about spiritual gifts. Nowhere in the Bible do we see the depth of teaching on spiritual gifts as we do in 1 Corinthians chapters 12 to 14. There's an incredible chapter kind of sandwiched or right in the middle of 12 and 14. It's 1 Corinthians 13. It's a passage that many of you have had heard read at weddings. Maybe if you're married here today and you had a Christian wedding, 1 Corinthians 13 was read at your wedding. It's that chapter on love that talks about what it means to love with the kind of love that God has. And while we sometimes picture that chapter as being a chapter that's all about the relational love between maybe a husband or a wife or a family, that's not the context that chapter is in at all. It's a chapter in the Bible that's all about the love that God's people have for each other. And it's a chapter in the Bible that the Apostle Paul put there with a church that was in crisis over the gifts that God had given to them. Because at the church of Corinth, some people with some gifts were trying to say that their gifts were more important than people with other gifts. And there was pettiness that was going on. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 8 to 11, Paul writes this: "For to one is given through the gift of Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit. To another gifts of healing by this one Spirit. To another the working of miracles. To another prophecy. To another the ability to distinguish between spirits. To another various kinds of tongues, and to another interpretation of tongues. And all these are empowered by one and the same Spirit who apportions to each one individually as he wills." One of many passages in Scripture that talk about spiritual gifts. In fact, there are dozens of passages in the Bible that refer to the gifts that God gives to his people. And the purpose of spiritual gifts is always for the building up, the edification of the body of Christ. It's so that God's body can grow together. In February, we're going to offer our next new members class. We do that often here, and if you ever attend our new members class, and we've got a kind of a new way of doing that, class 101, 201, 301, and 401. If you take class 301, you don't have to take these classes in order. You can just kind of take them when it works for you. Class 301 is all about spiritual gifts. The Bible talks, again, about all sorts of spiritual gifts that are given for the building up of the body of Christ. We're all familiar with gifts like preaching because you sit under it every week, or gifts like teaching or shepherding, pastoral gifts. There are also gifts like administration and hospitality and exhortation that the Bible talks about. Some have the spiritual gift of evangelism. It just seems like everywhere they go, the conversations that they have turn toward Christ and eternity and the most important matters in life. You know, some have the spiritual gift of craftsmanship. The Bible actually talks about a spiritual gift of craftsmanship in the Old Testament, where God had supernaturally given some people the ability to make beautiful things. And we've got people that have that gift here. Your pastor doesn't. I have the spiritual gift of, I can't even put toothpicks together and glue them together and make them look, you know, I can't do that, all right? So some of you have craftsmanship. Some of you have the gift of intercession. It's a gift of prayer, and you are incredible prayers. And you pray for others in this church in a deeper way than many others. Some have the spiritual gift of helping. You're that person that says, hey, just let me plug in wherever it is that you need help. I'll come alongside you. You need help setting up chairs? I'll help you set up chairs. You need help painting the building? I'll help you paint the building. What do you need help with? Count me in. Some of you have the spiritual gift of giving, and you have blessed this congregation with sacrificial giving over the years. There are so many other gifts that the Bible talks about. So I got a question for you today. Do you know what your spiritual gift is? The Bible tells us that everyone who's a follower of Jesus Christ, at the moment of salvation, God supernaturally gives everyone a spiritual gift. And sometimes the Lord gives that gift for a certain period of time, and we use that gift in incredible ways, and then he takes that gift away and he gives us a different gift. Because for this season in life, God wants us to operate in a different way. See, I'm convinced that God has given Woodbury Community Church every gift that we need to accomplish the purposes that he has called us to do right here, right now. It's just a matter of, are we going to be faithful to be the people to use the gifts that he's given to us? Are we going to exercise the gifts that God has given us and be used by him? Listen, as your pastor, this is not a message that I'm preaching to you because I see our church full of people who aren't using their gifts. It's quite the contrary. I'm blown away by the way that you use your gifts to serve God. There's something so rewarding in using our gifts to serve the Lord. I mean, I walk around this building and I see people like Tasha Hansen, who every Sunday morning is our nursery coordinator. And she gets volunteers and gets them together, and she just loves in our children. But you know what? Tasha also has the spiritual gift of intercession. I don't know anybody who prays like Tasha. It's just this passion for prayer. I see people like Jerry Vogler, who for the last year, again, has been working on kind of another vision team, because that's kind of what Jerry does. And God's gifted him in these incredible ways to talk with people and find out information and data. I think there were about 75 of you that were interviewed by the team that he's leading this year just to ask questions about why you're at Woodbury Community Church. And what Jerry finds out with those answers is so different than what I would ever find out with those answers, and it's so much better because God's gifted him in that area. And God has gifted him as a leader. I see Russ Lilladol, who was at our daughter church for a number of years and is back here now. And you know, while he was at our daughter church, he still came here and did work around our building. And now that he's back here, he's here one or two days a week just doing odd jobs around the building. And it's this beautiful way of using gifts. I see Jim Nygren, who has not only been the chairman of our board, but he's on our worship team and he's on our student ministry team. And this week he was installing toilets in the women's bathroom because he's willing to do things that need to be done around this building. And what a blessing. I see Peter Ockenborough back there, you know, running video for us on Sunday mornings and making sure that what we talk about here is something that can be communicated elsewhere. But Dad gave me a call last Sunday. He says, Brian, I tuned into Woodbury Community Church today. You weren't there. Who was the guy preaching? You know, I know he's watching today because he had surgery this week, and it's just a blessing to people sometimes when they can't make it to a church service to be able to tune in, and it's possible because of people like Peter and Carl and Dave back there on the soundboard. Shane McNamara back there, who has been kind of for the last couple of weeks designing our new webpage that we're going to kind of roll out at our annual meeting. You'll get to see kind of that being built and a little bit of the engine behind that. You know how much experience Shane has with building web pages? Not a bit, but he had time, and he said, hey, let me help you. And we've got this tool that makes it a little bit easier than maybe you might think. And what he's doing is absolutely beautiful because he says, hey, just let me help. I see Gloria Popowitz and Mark Popowitz who make things like this, things I could never make, and who will come here at Christmas time, and with just the two of them and whoever they can get around them. This year it was Therese Fahey and her girls decorate the whole church for Christmas. It's a huge sacrifice. You see, there's something beautiful about God's people using the gifts that God gives them. And I haven't even talked about our Sunday school teachers, our compassion ministry leaders, our worship team, our coffee team, our small group leaders. I could go on and on and on. The elders who serve this church so faithfully month in and month out. God is using people in this church to do great things. So how do we make today personal? Well, three things. Number one, I want to encourage you, if you've never taken a spiritual gifts test, to consider taking a spiritual gifts test this week. In the bulletin this week, we've got this little QR code. So if you're a QR code user, you have a smartphone, and you just download a QR code app, you can scan this, and it will take you right to an online test that will allow you to find out what your spiritual gift might be. And there's about 32 different spiritual gifts that the test measures. And, Yeah, we know those tests aren't foolproof. One of the best ways to find out what your spiritual gift is to ask people how they see Jesus in you. But this might give you a little bit more insight into what your gift is. Maybe your gift has changed over the years. Maybe you're at a different stage of life. And finding out what your spiritual gifts might be just the impetus that you need to say, God, how am I going to serve you in this next chapter of life? If you don't have a QR code, you can go to our website and go to the Life Together stage, go to the volunteer, or part of the website, go to the volunteer page, and there's a link to that test. Second way that you might make it personal this week is by looking at our ministry connection survey, which is also on that same page in the website. A lot of you say, you know what, I'd love to volunteer. I just don't know how to volunteer. Jen Ahmet is going to do something really cool for us in the year ahead, and that is that she's going to work with our staff and our key volunteers to take a look at all the volunteer ministry opportunities that we have here and tell you what kind of commitment that might be. Some people I know don't want to sign up for something that means you're committed every week for the rest of your life to this ministry, and it scares you, okay? There are some of the ministries that we have here that are a year-long commitment, like teaching Sunday school. There's other things that we do here that are a one-day commitment and a little bit of everything in between. And so we're going to try to help you with that. But the Ministry Connection Survey that we have on our website is one way that we can help you find a place where you can volunteer using the gifts that God has given you, the unique gifts that he's given you, to be able to serve in a way that I think will be a blessing to you, but will also be a blessing to WCC. Third way to make it personal this week is to take the pledge. And it would be pledge number 3 in the book, but it's our fourth week, so we're calling it the fourth pledge. Fourth pledge from the book, and that is right up here. Let's put it up. I will not let church be about my preferences and desires. That is self-serving. I'm a member in this church to serve others and to serve Christ. My Savior went to the cross for me. I can deal with any inconveniences and matters that just aren't my preference or style. That's something that's included in your sermon notes. And again, it comes from the book, I'm a Church Member by Tom Rainer. But as a pastor, let me just tell you, again, I've been blessed. I don't see a lot of this going on at WCC anyway, and that's awesome. I hope that it never becomes something like that here. And because we're kind of living that out anyway, I just want to encourage you, make that commitment here. Make the commitment to be somebody who will say, hey, it's not about me, it's about him. And I want to use the gifts that God's given me to make a difference in his kingdom forever. Would you pray with me as our worship team comes forward? Father, we thank you for today. Thank you for the opportunity that you give us to be part of the body of Christ. And Lord, I thank you for those in this room. This church is more than any one person. And God, it is also a church that you have strategically put in Woodbury, Minnesota, on the corner of Pioneer and Lake, in the geographical center of this community, so that we can make an impact for the kingdom. So God, help us as we continue through this series on being the church to say continually that we're not people who are just going to go to church, but we are the church. And God, as your church, we want to be used by you to be as effective as can be for the purpose of transforming this world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, as your people, we commit again to that vision that you gave us as a church many years ago to honor you by making more disciples for Jesus Christ. Help every one of us to live a life that's committed to that in the unique way that you've shaped us and formed us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.